The framing of this round seven topic deals with openness, it deals with inclusivity for a working network. So obviously it will require one touching on three different and distinct, if you like, areas given the framing. And again, obviously then it's good to demonstrate the very openness that I'm saying, and so that I say I'm affiliated with different organizations, some of them that are legal stewards of copyright law. And so it's also good to say therefore that what I speak is on my own behalf, so that I can be free to speak on all the three areas without any sort of attaching the views to an organization, a particular organization of many I'm associated with. So how am I going to do this? I'm going to look at it from three points. The first one will delve on the network architecture because of the networking. The second one, I'll touch on content. And then the third aspect I'll deal with will be on the governance of the two. But obviously within each one is touching on the other one. And therefore, to deal with openness and inclusivity in this, then obviously one must look at the structural exclusion or enclosure that exists or potentially exists that prevent what we'd want to achieve, because this is ideally what we have in round seven, is what we'd want to have. Some of the things have been mentioned, of course, given that we are on the second last panel of day two. But I want to deal with the network architecture, first of all, from the development of the standards. We started off and looking at what are maybe the structural exclusivity that exists in some of these issues. Now, and on these standards, I want to look at them again in two broad areas. One of them, that's the standard protocols and technologies. I want to look at them, one of them on the core for the internet. And what I mean by the core, I start off with right from address IPv6. Where most people, and I don't believe it's fair to say just from developing countries, I think even in this room, if you told somebody to talk of an IP version 6 addressing, I think not many of us would get it. Address version 4, I also know it would be a bit of a challenge to a good number of us. So already in this room, we are excluded from just the manner in which hosts or connected devices are mapped onto this network. We go on further down and start looking at other core technologies like DNSSEC, you know, some of these technologies which are unfortunately now are proprietary. You know, the internet used to be open, totally open back then. This is actually something that's very sign. They have baked themselves into the standards, the IETF, so that even the standards that are coming out are actually owned by certain people. So parts of the internet as we have it today is proprietary. So they may argue they do it for defense purposes, but then that's an argument or a suggestion they put. Nobody stops them in future, once you have all implemented a certain technology, to come knocking, asking for royalties because you're using a proprietary technology, whatever they are. Just like it happened a long time ago with some proprietary operating system, then people are led to pirate, so-called pirate, although we call it infringement. Then later on, including government, they came knocking, hey, you're using our software, pay for it. So it's another way of marketing this, and we know it in free software how that has happened. Now, this goes right down to actually the functional implementation of some of these core technologies. Now, we are told maybe for e-commerce that you have to have a padlock, we see, because that's a secure site. So who is implementing that? We have now a company that does that and that has special arrangements with the people that give it the rights, like VeriSign, you know, the trust, you know, you start getting, to trust that. Now, on the other hand, you have now what I call secondary, or sort of applications that run on the net. These include the network applications, the online platforms, of whichever one they are, the networking software that runs on the network, then registries and registrars that are granted rights to manage all these. We said we don't like the word ecosystem, the domain name, you know, they're the ones that have preferences. They are the ones determining what's going to happen. The people that hosts websites and content, the distribution, the geography. You know, it would be nice to have the statistic on Mac where they are located and how many of them and how much they command and how much money they earn every year in this business, the revenue renewing domain names where they are located geographically, northamerica.com.biz, you name it. And this now feeds back into that system. And that's why they have interest, the commercial interest in participating, and they fund their participation as equal stakeholders in this network, in the governance, which will be the third one. So they have business or commercial driven motivations or business models of getting involved and sustainable, but they don't exist in public interest. They exist for their own commercial and democratic and questioned, and they make decisions the way they want, and they are able, because of their business models, to actually be involved from the word go and even get other partners to speak on their behalf. In terms of their trust, at the end of this second one, they just tell you, trust us. We run this network or platform, read our terms, take it or leave it, but it's ours. But if we limit the number of people that should be on a platform, it's our own terms. So that's how they deal with their trust. The second thing I want to look at, still on the network, I dare add to this network neutrality, because it's also being driven by commercial and is affecting the core of the network. So then there's the whole category of ISPs and other people who are going to police this one. So these are issues that have to do with the network, that we are saying it's open, but at the same time we are finding it's getting closed, and they are going to police how this network will go. And we know there's quite a lot of discussion on that. So we can't talk of an open internet when it's actually not open, because certain very powerful forces are at the core, are the secondary, and are the connection, how the traffic is going. I move on to the second bit. This has to do now with the content that's running on all of this. Yeah, I heard about the licensing and how maybe private interests come and take over platforms that have been built on commons. Yeah, we do have licenses at Creative Commons that obligate you on how to share content which you obtain for free, the 6 licenses. So if something is non-commercial, you can't make it commercial. But I understand what you're saying, that if it's a business that is actually doing all of that, you may sell the business, but not necessarily the content. What I don't quite understand or know what would happen is, I don't think our licenses cover the business. It's the content. So maybe if a very successful commons enterprise comes online and it builds a lot and somebody buys it and just destroys it, I don't know. You know, I think that's not a content issue. So meaning, Mikel, I totally understand in terms of the business of where, like, the platform you mentioned was bought and a lot of free work that was put there. I understand that is a challenge, but it's not on the licensing of the content, but the business model built on top, which is quite true. Now, the other issue to raise on content is the argument I want to lead on to what I personally consider as the innovation dilemma. Now, traditional research starts off with a hypothesis, and you get the problem and you start looking for empirical data to approve or disapprove, and then you come whether your postulation is right. Now comes in the other research methodology, where this grounded theory, where you start with these massive pools of data and you don't know what to do with it, so you start looking for patterns. And then from the pattern you deduce, and therefore you arrive at conclusions. In this big data era, I think that has made the network users data a gold mine for this kind of approach. So you start off, and I give an example to make it easy, with a mobile operator that has got all the SMSs you have sent every year, and they write an algorithm, a script, to go through, check who is saying, I need to borrow some money, lend me, I'll pay you. And then if that word hits a certain number, you realize, oh, come on, this, I can make a product that maybe you lend people money. And so, because it's very popular, everybody wants to borrow money. So they say they are very innovative. They have invented a product that's solving a lot of problems. But in essence, it's the other way around. They actually collected your data over time, and so they're not even innovative. It's actually this personal data they are collecting, and they don't tell you this is what we did. They claim innovation. This location data, as we keep talking about the biometric data, we have like about 6 parameters that connect us where we are. There's the IP address of your phone, there's a GPS location of where you are, you find there is your account of your ISP, there's a number you registered on your mobile phone, there's MA, there are all manner of 3-point triangulation to locate you where you are at any point in time. And now there's software that is being sold commercially that can track any mobile user anywhere they are in the world, because the networks, mobile networks, have got very old and very cheap technology, that you know, they can basically log and find out wherever anybody is. So the problem is bigger. And so what we are finding is that the people in developing countries, certainly mine, I think, given, and pardon me for using this word, I think our level of engagement in terms of harnessing some of this information is a bit different from some of these other platform operators. So you find then it becomes a problem for our innovators. Now I go to the third and final point, that's on the management of peer production. On peer production, there is the whole idea of co-creation, which is called peer production. Now, historically, you find that there used to be that open access to the content, but if you look at a presentation to UNESCO in July by Lessig again, to UNESCO called Peace on Open Education Resources, is that you find that in mitigating this idea of openness, then we have to embrace new concepts of open education resources, which is something we have been doing with UNESCO, to mitigate against the closure, because a lot of private interest, intellectual property, copyright law is being used to block what was a free resource in the past. Copyright has been used, of course, in so many aspects, and that's why TPP, starting with COICA, SOPA, PIPA, all these are legal framework that have been coming to try and close the openness that was there on the network. And when they can't fly at the international level, they are tried at bilateral, regional cooperation agreements. So these are some of the threats we need to look at. I have 2 minutes and I want to close. I'll give my rest of the points as we go on. But I think what we need to look at is that we have to understand that beyond the infrastructure and the content, its presentation, and also context of how it's provided. There's the content amount, volume, and the presentation is what defines the new norms that define the new society. And therefore, if we have certain areas that don't have sufficient content, the new reality, which is an evolutionary thing, is redefined by the domineering content. So there's a bigger threat of new realities being created, new realities, by the amount of content that's there. And you can't be a lone voice fighting so much norm which has been created by the other one. So there are suffocation or suppression or subduing of certain points of view by the overwhelming amount of content in the region. So this requires to be looked into to figure out how it can be mitigated against. Finally, there is a whole idea of the open data. Open data, yes, there are some initiatives that have been personally driven, like in my country, but at the same time, we have to ask, as you are told to open the agenda for openness, we must also check how it's benefiting. If there are people who don't have connectivity and their governments are being told to be so open, is it for corporates to come and now even get all the sick people's information in their country so that their farmer can know which region people are about to get headaches and so they can hike the prices? Or is it really to help the people in that region access freedom of information in that region? So the relative benefit, cost and benefit analysis. So we cannot always take an ideal situation when it suits certain environment and ignore it totally when it doesn't suit that argument. Access to knowledge is good, access to information is good, but we must also look at it in the practice of access to knowledge and also content generation and limitations as into involvement in that system. And I will stop there because there are other, final, I think one final point, I just want to talk on governance. The largest meeting of ICANN participants was recently held in London, and there were 3,000. It was the largest ever attended. Largest IGF meeting was in Nairobi, there were over 2,000. Now, even if you combine these two numbers and had 5,000 people deciding on all this consensus on equal footing, 5,000 out of 3 billion people who are connected, all 5,000 out of 7.2 billion, assuming each is a distinct person in either IGF or ICANN, I think that's a very small number to decide on the fate of a world that has got 7.2 billion. So participation in that model, there are lots of questions that could be improved to ensure that the inclusivity and openness of our decision are done so that you have a proper network that serves the global public interest. I'll stop there in the interest of time. Thank you.